Okay, thank you, Steve. Kimberly.
Councilman McShane's comments, I know going through it, we had some concerns. Obviously, there are, you know, we are constantly faced with fiscal crisis. In the year I have been here, that has been the word that we have used for every single topic that we have to cover here in the city of Salinas. And definitely, $450,000 a year for 3 years is a chunk of change to let go, but also recognizing Councilwoman Lutz's point, we have the opportunity to operate it ourselves for $1.4 million. So recognizing that that's a no-brainer, I do want to point out to Adrian, Jarnell, Pauline, Alex, Elisa, Elizabeth, and Corinne. Okay, first of all, thanks for hanging with us for 2 hours in a not so interesting city council meeting. But also, I want to thank you because your voice tonight changed a mind. So just know that. And know that the skills that you are learning at First Tee are applicable in real life where you get up and you speak during public comment and you are able to change minds of decision makers. So thank you for that. And I commend you for being out here tonight. Thanks.
Okay, Gloria.
And I just want to say congratulations to the First Tee, the executive director, the board of directors, the youth for being here tonight. I can tell you as a nurse, I was very, very proud and very honored to hear a family in my job. Well, I do a lot of chronic disease education and physical activity for children. And I asked the mom, I said, what is your child involved in? And she says, she looked at the clock and she says, I only have 15 minutes because she was telling me, she goes, I have to pick up my child because the bus, they go to First Tee, the golf. So she was telling me all about the program. I had already visited. I had been there a while. And she was telling me all about the program and exactly saying the character building, the lifestyle changes that the child had made. And I just listened to her and I said, you know what? I'm proud of that program also. And she says, our kids from our school, I think it's Cesar Chavez or Frank Paul, she was saying, all the kids are excited when they have to go on the bus to go to First Tee for golf. And so again, thank you for the wonderful job that you're doing in our city. And I also wanted to say, Margaret, you're right, the golf. I remember Nancy Martinez, I think she was a Latina that played golf. We probably have someone right now that's a Nancy Martinez, and we have a Tiger Woods, right? I know we do. So we will be known for golf, Councilmember McShane. We have some kids, some youth that are going to be pro golfers, right? So anyways, again, thank you for everything, and this is money well spent.
Okay. Just a couple things. In theory, we don't vote count, but I think you can kind of see where this is heading. Just a couple things. You know, it's interesting if you take a moment to let words sink in, like safe place, help become better people, honesty, judgment, core values from the customers. Good stuff. And one of the things I want to do is really thank you, those of you who are responsible for the First Tee operation in Salinas and Monterey County, for your unyielding commitment to try and find a way to make this work in Salinas. One of the things that and it's been stated a couple times here, you know, the comment of Santa Cruz, King City. I always enjoy pointing out that one of the and I think it's becoming less of a secret, but one of the best kept secrets in recent years is how folks from all over and from the peninsula continue to come forward and work with Salinas. And I think that really should be noted for the record. One of the things when I'm visiting with young people at risk, I like to point out is folks who have never met you, go to great lengths to give you opportunities. And I think that's a big, that's a big statement, because you end up with you know, terrific ambassadors for the program. So well done, and thank you. The other thing is, I was particularly struck, and I was glad it came up, that for many young people, this is their green space. And, you know, this is a city that's about at 2/5 of the national average in terms of open space. So in many respects, this is it. And so I think that's worth noting. And 6,000 on its way to 7,000 young people participating, this is the largest youth program in Monterey County. So that should be noted for the record. And then the other thing that I like is, when you think back over the years and in recent years, when a number of us began to work together around a peace initiative and the Community Alliance of Safety and Peace, and upping the library's budget from what it was prior to Measure B to pick up an additional $300,000 or $400,000. So a lot of that mobile bookmobiles, the ability to reach out. One of the things I'm really proud of this council, through thick or thin, Councilmember Craig is correct. You know, fiscal crisis, you know, frankly, that stretches back in this city a couple of decades, and that's a different story for another time. But 5 years ago, we planted a flag around, we're going to think long term. We're going to think about prevention. We're going to think about intervention. And at the time, we allocated about $1 million for prevention and intervention, and we had a couple of different programs. Now, those programs have changed, but what has not changed is, when you look at the investment we've made at CASP in terms of personnel up in the ante with what we're doing with the library and this $450,000, we are on or about $800,000 to $1 million a year, as we said we would be several years ago with prevention programs. You cannot do everything, but this is sure a good thing. And it's a heck of a flag to plant, because in our community, it isn't that we don't know what to do, but so often it's really a matter of scale and capacity. And so that's one of the things I always kind of like about city council meetings is, you know, and obviously there's a lot going on, and council meetings have varying degrees of attendance, but we're doing something really important tonight. As a result of a lot of people working together. And that should not be lost for the record. As events swirl around us, the council, in conjunction with community, is doing the exact right thing for the future of this city. Those are good moments. So we ought to savor that. And I would just close with this. There's been a comment made about we are just kind of a general sense of, hey, we're throwing in $450,000. I think it's really important to note that in a city, all we do basically is services. We essentially subsidize everything. You know, the police department is not about a profit. Putting out a fire is not about a profit. So when we make a decision like this, you know, fundamentally, we don't do profit. We make decisions about where's the right place, and I'm sure everyone can appreciate what I'm about to say, as Margaret said, putting the right amount of dollars in the right places. This is really a right place, and that really should be noted. But I want to have folks think a little bit about this notion of, this is somehow different than other things we do. That's essentially what cities do. They make choices of services they will provide, and it's really not about a loss, because technically, more often than not, that's exactly what we're doing. But I don't know how it's a loss to think about a safe place, becoming better people, honesty, judgment, and core values. I'm pretty sure that's a gain or a win. It's above any baseline I can think of. So with that, there's a motion and a second. Let's call for the question.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yes. All right, thank you, everyone. I think I heard, just like it was golf, and let's say we can't have a golf clap. Those are shorter than most. You're done, that's it, they're done. Golf, gotta be quiet, someone else is teeing up. All right, thank you, everyone. Okay, now we're gonna do stuff that is arguably not nearly as fun and talk about sanitary fees. And frankly, Matt, I mean, I'm not really excited, but apparently we have to do it. It's on the agenda, it's on the script. I got a lot of yellow marks that say we're gonna do it. Though, don't take that personally. I always enjoy seeing you. But Matt, you're on. Try and follow that.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Okay, before you is an ordinance amending our municipal code. Basically, we have in our municipal code setting our sanitary sewer rates at 35% of the MRWPCA's rate. Ordinance will adjust the code to allow the rates to be set by a resolution. And back in November 15th, council received a report that showed the proposed new rates. A public hearing was set for January 10th, and that's when the city council would choose to adopt a resolution to approve those rates. So this kind of sets us up to move forward in that venue. And that concludes my report. Thank you.
I will say this. I like the length of your report. That was really good, insightful, well done, precise, to the point. Good. Any questions? I kind of thought it spoke for itself, but I shouldn't throw in any editorial early on. Public, you want in on this? Back to council.
Move to approve.
Second.
I knew there would be fighting over a motion to approve in a second. I think we just jump right to calling for the question.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yep. All right, but I'm checking with the city attorney to see if it's okay to conduct business in less than a minute, Matt.
Wow, that was fast.
Excuse me, just for the record, that was an ordinance introduction.
Okay.
In your exuberance.
Introducing an ordinance. There was a lot of exuberance. Look at the excitement you cause every time you come to take the diet. That's very good. Let's see if you
We just introduced an ordinance.
Since we were just introducing, does he get to come back next week?
You get to vote on it again.
I'm excited. All right. Jeff, you're on. Matt, do you want to do another item while we're waiting for Jeff? Because apparently you can get it done by the time he's ready. You want to do four? We can do an action plan or something while we're waiting for him. Grace, I want you to pay close attention to Matt's example. Chimpia made me say that, so I had no choice.
This is a hard one to follow. Excuse me. Mayor, members of the council, and members of the public that are still here, members of the staff. What you have before you is a recommendation to approve a resolution that modifies the current economic development investment policy guidelines, adding seven items that have been run by the Finance Committee, I believe, on October 25th. We also are recommending that we rename the policy itself to an Economic Development Incentive and Investment Policy. because our major focus is on investments of both time, money, and opportunities as we go into the future. We come before you following what happened recently with Green Vehicles and their filing for bankruptcy. The council asked us to come back with recommendations of places or items or suggestions of how we could improve the current policy. That's what you have before you this evening. What I'd like to do is just briefly show you the seven items. The first item is to assign the monitoring of any agreement and all of the associated activities thereof to both myself or someone in economic development and someone in finance. We did not have that as clear as we should have before. We felt it was a weakness, and now we want to make it part of our new policy that we will actually have someone assigned to do this. Second item is to require information regarding ownership structure. I think this was one of the things that we did learn from the Green Vehicle experience. We didn't clearly understand who was involved and on the investment level. We're also requiring that whoever we engage with, we have information about board of directors meetings, minutes and thereof, because what we did find again is that certain things took place that we only learned of much later. If we would have known in the very time it occurred, we could have prevented some things from happening, we feel. Third item is to show that anyone we are involved with, whether we're providing a grant, whether we're providing an incentive or whatever, that they must show us they have the financial capability, including, if necessary, personal guarantees. And I just share with you briefly that we really have taken this to heart. It's exactly what we did with the Taylor Fresh Foods project. For the first time, we actually required, very, very stringently required, all kinds of financial information that was difficult for them to share with us, but they did. And we did that with the understanding this is what we're going to do as we go forward. The last thing that what I would mention on here is something called clawbacks, and we can talk about that, but a clawback event is effectively is the ability for us to recover, and we'll be adding that wherever we need to. The clawback, as mentioned here, is also will be applied any time that we are advancing anything. We're going to make sure we're protected, and we'll become better at this as time goes on. Any direct financial contribution commitments, such as we did with CDBG grant for hiring of employees, we want to assure the employees have been hired and that they are actually qualified before we make any advancement of the funds. We'll make this clear if we do any of that going forward. We'll make it as clear as looking through a pane of glass. Again, this is something that we just kind of acknowledge it was a little bit of a weakness in the policy. The other part thing, then, this is really important, if there's a third-party instrument, and in this case, what I'm talking about is something such as a California Energy Commission grant. We thought we understood the grant. We thought we understood how the money would get paid out. In retrospect, in hindsight, when we went and we looked, we didn't clearly understand it enough. What we're recommending now is that we get information from someone who does know these things. It'll be paid for by the applicant, not by the city, and it'll be just as clear as it can be exactly what's going on. Again, this is probably one of the two things, not understanding the financial investment structure and understanding the grant, probably the major deficiencies with Green Vehicles. Lastly, we're recommending that we have to go at least two times to the Finance Committee, that we allow ourselves time to understand fully what is going on. And the Finance Committee will be much more directly involved right from the very beginning, not just to bring something forward and talk about a potential incentive agreement or some relationship and look at it just before it comes to the council. So we understand we need to give ourselves more time. These are the recommendations. The policy that you have in front of you indicates those changes. The resolution asks you to go ahead and approve that. And with that, I'll be pleased to answer any questions.
Okay, questions from council. To my right. To my left. Public.
Name is Eric Peterson, and I didn't have a chance to read the report, but I just wasn't entirely clear on what you meant by personal guarantees. And what I would like to suggest is that any paper be recorded. It definitely be something that could be recorded with the Secretary of State or County Recorder as appropriate to make sure it encumbers something. And I really like the idea about not hurrying on this. Giving plenty of time and thought could help a lot of things. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric. Okay, anyone else? Okay, back to council. Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, I just think it's worth noting that there was enormous public pressure in response to green vehicles and council interest in bringing about what I think is a good set of reform presented by Mr. Weir. So, Jeff, you've done a great job. I'm really excited by what's come forward. So, nice work.
Thank you.
Jill?
Well, this also went to the Finance Committee at one point, and I think, Jeff, this is very thorough and well done, and I think that if we have this in place, that we can feel a lot more confident about decisions that we make from now on.
Okay. All right. Good. All right. Anyone else? Okay. Is there, I'm looking for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. First and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
We're just all so excited. I think you can, anyone who didn't like it, speak up. Apparently, though we probably should be a little more official than that.
I agree, Mayor.
You're right.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yes, and let the record show what a mischievous council it is. So, all right. Very good. You know, Matt, what? That was close. He almost came after you there, but now we'll see how Grace does.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of the council, we're considering proposed amendments. I'm sorry, you are considering proposed amendments for fiscal year 10-11, 09, and 09-10. The proposed amendments are considered substantial in nature. That's why we are holding today's duly noticed public hearing regarding changes in the planned uses of HUD grant funds. As you may recall, last September, I reported to council as part of the city's CAPER, which is the annual report provided to HUD, that the nonprofit Neighborhood Housing Services of Silicon Valley, whom the city had partnered with to coordinate and manage our first-time homebuyer program, decided to close their doors, ending our one-year pilot program. And also, as you may recall, council did approve an allocation for them for $500,000 of both CDBG and home funds for the program, and that CDFI funds were to be used dollar for dollar. A total allocation was also approved for $60,000 for administrative costs. So today, staff is proposing for housing to assume the coordination of the first-time homebuyer program and reallocate the funds back to the city. The Housing Division managed the city's first-time homebuyer program from 94 to 2006, which ended due to the high real estate prices. Our plan is to use $500,000 to assist 16 households, each for $20,000 of a down payment assistance, and six for $25,000 each for our target area, which is the Alisal homeownership neighborhood and revitalization area. The balance of the $30,000 to be used for lead-based paint remediation work, and the remaining balance of the $60,000, which is now at $43,743.46 administrative budget, will be now brought back for administrative costs for the Housing Division. So just some of the basic loan terms and requirements. It's going to be a 3% deferred loan for 30 years, so there's no monthly payments required. It is for eligible low-income city of Salinas. They have to be either a resident or employed in the city of Salinas. The property must be their principal place of residence. It's on a first-come, first-served basis. And they would need to attend a HUD-approved homebuyer counseling through the Housing Resource Center. The Housing Resource Center is assisting already in our NSP application process, and so they will be doing that as well for our first-time homebuyer program. Lastly, I want to point out that in the past, city programs cannot be combined with other programs, as this would be considered double dipping. So in conclusion, staff recommends that council adopt the prepared resolution approving the plan amendments so that housing Housing may assume coordination and management of the first-time homebuyer program. And secondly, staff is asking council to affirm the determination that first-time homebuyer participants may only participate in one affordable housing program, for example, using the down payment to buy an NSP property. Thank you.
I'm supposed to note for the record, we have all been part of a real live public hearing as opposed to a consideration item, which I think really raises the stakes and makes it pretty darn exciting. So let's see if there are any questions on all this. There are not. There are. Or there
is. A big chunk of what you do kind of hinges on the federal budget. What does your crystal ball tell you years into the future? I mean, I'm sure you're networked. You must go to the You may be on a different circuit than I am. I know plants, you know federal dollars. While we've got you here, you know, you're here, you could just kind of
sure. I don't have a percentage reduction, but there are definite reductions in both CDBG and home that have passed Congress.
We're talking 50, 20?
Last year it was, I believe, at 16% and, 14 and 16%. The numbers that they release in Congress are percentages, but it doesn't, because we're on a formula allocation, they do another calculation to see how much we get. So that doesn't necessarily mean when they say 20% reduction that we're actually going to get a 20% reduction. So at this point, I just know that there are definite reductions in both CDBG and home and an increase in ESG for the homeless, which is the homeless program.
Okay. All right. Public comment.
Did I understand right that the $500,000 is coming back that was shipped up to San Jose? Did I understand that correctly? That's just a question.
Just hang tight. We'll get it for you. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, we will come back to council. Can you clarify that before we comment?
So the original allocation was provided to neighborhood house NHSSV for properties within the city of Salinas. So managing our program, not in San Jose. So as that program didn't work out, we are now assuming the same responsibilities.
Okay. Thank you. All right. To council, question or comment from Council Member Sanchez.
Just a comment. I think that we should continue to be in touch with Neighborhood Housing Services. I think they provided a very valuable service, and I know personally we send from our office of Assembly Member Lejo, we send a lot of people to them, and they really did take care of them and walk them through all the different things. And one thing that should be known about Neighborhood Housing Services is that they're the only nonprofit that is allowed to be a lending institution similar to a bank, and that's the only one of existence in the entire United States. No other nonprofits allowed to do banking and to be allowed to do lending. So they were not only helping with all the different issues, but they were also a lending institution. And so we should continue to have a communication, but definitely a relationship with them, because I think we just need to work with them as funding becomes available to come back to Salinas. The need is great. One thing you should know, the executive director of that organization was Ed Moncrief, which started a lot of organizations in this community, including Chispa. But he retired, and Matt Huerta, our former planning commissioner, became the executive director of that. So we should definitely keep in touch with them. We should definitely encourage them to come back as funding becomes available and maybe jointly apply for funds because, again, the need is great. Them leaving town and then bringing it back to the city just leaves a huge void when it comes to this. People are literally, hundreds of people are losing their homes in Monterey County every month, and in Salinas is where the greatest amount of people are losing their homes. And this goes for seniors, people of all different economic levels. And so it's a real problem, and it creates blight. It creates a lot of dislocation of families. And so we should definitely continue to work with neighborhood services and see if we can bring them back to town. They're a great organization, and we have some friends in there. But other than that, I think we got to do what we got to do. We got to move on.
Anyone else?
I'd like to make a
And I'm glad to see that we have the first home time buyers program, because that's going to give, you know, 16 homes, you said? Yeah.
16 and six
right
in the target area.
Exactly. So that's, I mean, that is so wonderful for our community members that are going to be able to qualify for that first time buyers. So I'm glad.
Okay. Okay. All right. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yes. Okay, with that, we will head off into a closed session to discuss items A, B, and D, and we adjourn in the memory of Kenneth Wallace. So, thank you, everyone.